I guess we can call this setting up your five-string bass. I don't do a lot of these, and I gotta be honest, the five-string bass was invented way after I started playing, so I never had any desire to adapt or to become part of it. As far as I can tell, this big fat string they added, it used to be a thumb rest. Now you've got a string to rest your thumb on when you're playing. That's sort of my take on it, especially when I watch guys play it. Usually they're resting their thumb here. That's about what that's good for. That's Dave's joke of the day. I'm going right off of the Fender website that talks about how to set up your bass guitar. It's a little different than I do it. I'm sure the results are just as decent or accurate. I'd hope they'd be. Otherwise, we're all in trouble. So let's begin with setting up your five-string bass guitar. First thing is you'd hope that the intonation is at least close or roughed in. You're going to be looking for a pattern like this when you look at the bridge saddles. Now what you can do is you can actually measure the first one. So you measure from the nut to the 12th fret, and then from the 12th fret to this very first saddle. And that should be very, very close to being perfect. The next thing to do is add the diameter of each string to the difference. So the diameter of this string is the difference between these two. Next, the diameter of this string is the difference between those two, so on and so forth till you reach the big fat string. This should make it really close. Really close. Not necessarily perfect, but close enough to start your setup, because we're going to check this again at the end as the last procedure. So we got the intonation roughed in, and the next thing on the list is that good old neck relief, that curve in the neck that we need so the strings have enough room to vibrate. So we get the old capo out. This is like a three-handed trick, so I'm going to maybe put the camera down and begin this again. Just stand by. Didn't need to hear that. Get your capo on the first fret. Now this is right off the Fender website. What they say to do is to fret the last fret and measure the gap at the eighth fret. This is a little bit of a magic trick, as you can see. If you had three hands, you'd be doing better than I'm doing. And depending on the neck radius, they give different gaps. This happens to be a 10, and they say that the gap should be about 12 thou. And by Lord, that's pretty much what we got. I wouldn't touch that. I did do this before I started the video, so the guitar's set up. I'm just going through the motions, just so everybody knows. Hold on to your hats and whatever else you're holding on to. We'll just go through this truss rod adjustment stuff. Right is tight, left is loose, left gives more curve, right takes away the curve. I would recommend loosening your strings a little bit when you're adjusting the truss rod, especially on one of these five bangers. There's a lot of string tension on this neck. We don't want to pop the truss rod or strip the nut or all of the above. Oh, the Kentucky Fried Chicken I had is coming back. What a terrible experience that was. Why did I do that to myself? And just another little rule. The more curved the fretboard is, the greater the radius, the more relief you'll need. And that's because there's more fretboard in the way, basically. The flatter the neck, the less relief you need. That's why ripper guitar players, shredding guitars, have that really flat radius and they hardly need any relief whatsoever. So now that we've conquered that, we're going to set the string action. Stand by for that. Okay, so we measure this at the 17th fret according to the Fender guidebook there that I'm looking at, and once again, depending on the neck radius, they recommend 7/64s to 5/64s. 6/64s would be your ideal center sort of specification. If you're really brave, you can set it down to 5. If you're not so brave, you can have it up to 7. Now, what happened on this bass guitar when I set it all up the way they said to set it up, we had 2 high frets here that had to be dressed down so that they all played. We had tons of fret buzz in this area. So even in a perfect world, things aren't quite perfect, as you can understand. So what you need is a ruler that'll do that. That'll either do, this one only goes as little as 16th, so it's useless. This is this crazy Stumac thing, which was designed for measuring this sort of stuff. One of the few tools that they've come up with that actually makes sense. And I shouldn't say that. They have tools that make sense. They just cost too much. By the time you've figured it out to do it yourself, you've paid for the tool 10 times over. Let's continue down the list of things we need to check out. We want to set the pickup height. So this is, we press the string down at the last fret and we measure the gap between the pole and the string itself. The Fender numbers are on the website that I'm going to put in the description right down below here. I'm going to put this link that I've been reading from today, and you guys can decide where you want to adjust your pickup height to. That's what I'll let you know about that. It's all about little numbers measured with a little ruler. Finally, they also talk about shimming the neck for proper tilt or micro tilt adjustments. And they also mention that if you're not comfortable doing this, take it to somebody who is. It's the best advice I can give you. If you're not comfortable, if you don't feel confident, if you think you're going to goof it up, then please, by all means, take it to someone who's got more skill and more expertise, more experience. They're going to help you out a lot, believe me. Finally, we're going to recheck the intonation in the playing position, fretting the 12th fret, and making sure that both notes match. You'll need some sort of a guitar tuner for that. The better the tuner, the better off you're going to be. And once again, you guys know that I like to use the Peterson. Can't say enough about that. So let's finish that off and maybe plug this in and see what it makes a noise like. And everybody knows you change the intonation by moving the saddles back and forth here. That's this screw at the end. Once again, it's not a bad idea to loosen the strings off. When you do that, it just makes things move a little easier. Son of a sea cook, huh? Whoa, is that a big old floppy note there? Wow! Okay, upper register. Those all work, they didn't before very well. I just can't get used to this. It's like this big, fat, super big thing that... So I guess if you started on a 5-string, you wouldn't know any better. But I do know better. Like I said, this just becomes a big thumb rest. Fingers don't go to the right spots. Anyway, that's it. This is a Fender 5-string jazz bass made in Mexico. And that's my video for today. Cheers, folks. Oh yeah, don't forget, I'm going to put the link to that Fender procedure. Excuse me. Oh God, that Colonel Chicken is just killing me. That procedure down below in the description, so you can check that out. Thanks again. Cheers.